Hello. Here I am in front of the wall of books where I first started my actual webcam vlogging back, oh my goodness, 2008. 8 years ago. I'd been on YouTube for 2 years since the summer of 2006, but I hadn't done any real vlogging. I'd just done some collaging and making up stuff, and hadn't done any work with a camera until I made some comment about how I didn't have a camera, and Morphine, you know, Steve, one of the old timers at VH, said, "Oh, I'll send you one," and he sent me one. I think I've still got it up here in the cupboard somewhere. Oh, I should have gotten it out before I started this, because I've decided, except for a tiny bit of inserting, this is going to be a pure vlog, mostly unedited. Anyhow, when I sat down to make this, I thought about the webcam and how Steve had sent it to me. And I still couldn't get out and make videos. And then Frank heard me say something about that, and he sent me a... Oh, God, I should have gotten that camera. That one's up in this one. I think this is it. No, that's somebody else's camera. Well, hell. Talk about being prepared, you know. That's the trouble with vlogging, is you just flang it on the cliff. I mean, a real vlog, real. Even, you know, there's pure vlogs, and there's real vlogs, and there's edited vlogs. So everything's a vlog, but there's a certain point where you start to cross the line where you're not just cinema verite, direct cinema, true cinema. You're becoming an edited show. And I'll move this and get it a little bit. Anyhow, so Frank sent me a camera, which is how I made some of my very first outdoor videos. And then after somebody mentioned a cheap little flip clamp. Oh, that's probably up in that cupboard too, right up there. Maybe if I open the door, you can see it on the camera. No, you can't. It doesn't open wide enough, but you can hear it. So, and then in 2012, after I'd already been to Disneyland many times with my little flip cam, a little Tony this big, I bought a $400 Sony HD, which is now sitting in the house, because I wanted to come out here and use the webcam. Today, really what I wanted to talk about today was the thrill I got when I saw something on the internet. It came about because the woman I work for, she runs a translating business in Tijuana, and she sends me stuff over the internet, and I translate it from Spanish into English, and then I send it back to her. Well, the first people we worked for back in 2003, I think that was when I had my first translating work, was for the Institute for Philological Investigations of the Autonomous University of Mexico, or its initials in Spanish are UNAM-IIFE, UNAM-IIF. And they built a website which you can look for at unpasadovisible.com, UNPASADOVISIBLE.com. And we translated poems for that website. We weren't the only ones. There was a whole crew of translators. And if you want to see My little curriculum vitae, little tiny shotgun biography, posted back in 2004, I think it was, when the website finally got up and going. No, it was 2003. We must have been working in 2002. Memory, oh my, don't trust memory. You have to corroborate it. Anyhow, they liked our work. So, and they liked the woman I work for. She studied with them at the university in Mexico City. So they've had us every year since then, once or twice a year. We translate little tiny blurbs. They print a big magazine. It comes out, it's a book, it's about that thick, full of articles, literary articles. And now we don't translate the articles. What we do is we translate little paragraphs, 10 or 12 paragraphs, one about each of the articles, saying what the article's about in English. They call the, in English, in the literary world, it's called abstract. But they call them resumens. Resumen. It's like a, you know, whatever. You can't say it exactly because the words mean different things. Resume in English means start all over again. But resume doesn't mean start all over again. It's a summation of all of your accomplishments. And that's what resumen means. That you take a whole thing and boil it down to a paragraph. Or as it's called in English, in the English literary world, or American English literary world, abstracts. So we've been doing that for them, and they don't pay us money. They pay us free books. Unfortunately for me. Oh God, I probably have one or two of the books out here too. I love the books they put out. All this stuff about ancient Mayas and Aztecs, and as well as your usual encyclopedia of literary subjects, so-and-so and this person and that person and this novel and that novel, but it's all Mexican, which is why they have the Aztec and the Maya stuff. Yeah. I gotta look at the camera. If I look at the screen, oh see, I'm looking at the screen. Now I'm looking at the camera. If I lean back, I can hide my eyes and you won't know I'm looking at the screen. So, they have given us something a little bit larger now. They're building a website for the whole magazine. And we've been asked to do a few pages to start with. And I had to look at this pretty hard because, you know, we've always said yes to them, but it's always been little jobs, except for the first one, which was big and beautiful. And that was the first money I made on translating. I made over $1,000 back in 2003. I remember it, because after I got paid, I went on a trip. I went to Texas by train from L.A., and I saw Maria Teresa, and I went to her niece's quinceañera. Two nieces, double quinceañera. I went there and the party and saw the family, and then I think I stayed two nights in Nuevo Laredo, just across the river from Laredo in Tamaulipas. And then I took the bus south to the northern half of the state of Veracruz, which is way down in the tropics, you know. And I went to the ruins of El Tajín, which is near the beautiful little town of, little city, large town of Papantla. Lovely colonial architecture. About 10 miles by minibus from the ruins of El Tahi. And I stayed there for, oh my God, 4 or 5 nights. Went to the ruins again and again and again. Hung out with a couple of gringos that I met there. And then I came home, and that was 2003. That's why I remember that, because that's when the trip was. So these people who put up that poetry website, Un Pasado Visible, bunch of poems written about ancient Aztec art and pyramid ruins and stuff. We translated some of them. Anyhow, we've been working for them through the years, being paid with books. And I have had to think carefully about this, because if we say yes, we'll have to go through the whole thing. So I thought to myself, well, I'm going to look them up on the internet and see what they're doing now. And they've got a website now. It's only for the magazine. Doesn't have a lot of information, but it has a few things. Among which is a page that says editorial board. And on the page that says editorial board, there's a list of names. There's the director, and then there's a couple more names, and then there's the big list of the main editorial board, who are all these high-powered Mexican intellectuals. Leon Portilla. I didn't say Portillo. I said Leon Portilla. And more and more. Jose Pacheco, who came to speak at the writers' conference in Hermosillo a few years ago. On and on. There's like 20, 30 big names right there. The council. And down at the bottom are two names, the translators. And then it says Luisa Ruiz, Daniel Thomas. And when I saw my name there on their website, I just got this little, a rush. I just got freaking high that I have been building a new career for myself in my old age as a translator. And now, to be honest, that's why we've worked for these people. Not because they pay well, because they don't. They're poets. They don't have a lot of money, and all the money they can get from grants goes for operating expenses. And almost everybody involved gets his and her, because the director is a woman, get their pay from their real life jobs as professors and editors from other magazines and writers and published novelists. I'd say almost all of them teach one way or another. That's a very ancient tradition that writers and artists teach. Oh yeah, it's a very old tradition. And it's still very true. Anyhow, but there were my good friend Luisa and I down at the bottom with the translators. And that just made me feel so good that somebody gave us a little bit of credit. So yeah, I had to ask Luisa. I said, yeah, do you want to do this for books and for prestige? And she wrote me back, yeah, I do. So I said yes. And this is kind of an important step, you know, because sometimes people ask you things, and if you turn them down, they'll never ask you again. But if you say yes, you might get in over your head. But too bad. Make hay while the sun shines. Strike while the iron is hot. And all of that. Oh, my. I was going to insert the little picture of screen cap of the Literaria Mexicana webpage, but I didn't. So, since we're almost at 16 minutes, I'm just going to say bye-bye, my vlogging friends. Thanks for hanging in here with me.